Thank you for invitation and introduction. This is today's my title. Because my talk is the last session of this today, and so you may be tired. And I know welcome dinner is waiting, so I'll try to finish as early as possible. Yeah. I'll talk about the ruled minimal surfaces in three-dimensional homogeneous spaces. This is the example of a ruled minimal surface in R3. So it's a well-known theorem of Catalan. So in fact, this surface has a line here. It will be the axis of the square motion. And this geodesic is a ruling geodesic. It's orthogonal to that axis. And then you take the image of this ruling geodesic under the square motion, then you get this helicoid. And this will be the rough definition of a helicoid in my talk. What is simply connected to homogeneous spaces? It's a definition of a homogeneous space. And the metric is classified by the dimension of the isometric group. And when dimension is 6, they are space forms. So roughly speaking again, translations gives 3 dimensions, and rotations gives 3 dimensions again. And when dimension is 4, there are 2 parameter families here. 2 parameter is the kappa and tau. I will explain it later. And when dimension is 3, it's called the sol geometry. And in this case, the dimension is 4 because translation gives 3 dimensions, and the rotation with respect to the spatial direction gives 1 dimensions. And this space has no rotation as an isometry. So this is a known result. So in R3, it's the only non-trivial ruled minimal surface is a helicoid. And the same is true in S3. This is the well-known result of Lawson. This parameterization is a parameterization of a helicoid. In H3, the same is true. It's Docarmo and Dutra's result. And in the case of these spaces, the same is true. So this space has a very special direction in R direction, in fiber direction. So we just consider the helicoidal motion, a square motion along that axis, then the helicoids is the only non-trivial examples of the ruled minimal surfaces. So Kim and Shin Yang is my collaborator. And this result is published in Pacific Journal. They are my collaborators. Professor Young-woo Kim at Korean University in Seoul, and Professor Hae-yong Shin at Chungang University in Seoul, and Professor Yang Song-dok Yang at Korea University in Seoul. It looks like a cigarette, but he's a non-smoker. Yeah. And our result is here. In NIL3, I will explain it later, this space. The same is essentially true, is our result. This result will appear in, again, Pacific Journal. And we have a new result. The result is the space here. And the conclusion is the same. The helicoids are the only non-trivial examples of a ruled minimal surfaces. Yes. Yeah, this is the picture of a ruled minimal surface in S2 cross R. I'd like to explain this picture. So if you So, for example, you have two pictures of this surface. One is the cylinder, usual one. And another one can be either this, like this one, S1. So the X is here. This is R. And S1. Topologically here. Then this picture is the following the idea of this picture. S2 is here, another S2 is here, another S2 is here. And the geodesic 2S2 is a great circle. They rotate along this line. Then you have this picture. So, like a Möbius strip. This picture, I was impressed by this picture. It's the idea of Professor Yang Ho-kien. And this is the only non-trivial ruled minimal surface length to cross R. It's a helicoid, in fact. This is the axis. And the geodesics rotates along the axis and comes up in the same time. In case H to cross R, we have three types of helicoids. It's because, so this is the Poincaré disk, the model of H2. Then in the Poincaré disk, there are three types of rotation according to the location of the center of the rotation. When the rotation center is in the disk, then we call it as an elliptic rotation. When the center of the rotation is at the boundary, we call it as parabolic rotation. And the center is at the outside of the, maybe here, outside of the disk, then we call it as a hyperbolic rotation. So there are three types of helicoids. So it's called the elliptic helicoid. This is called the parabolic helicoid and hyperbolic helicoid. This is the parametrization of elliptic helicoids. But in this expression, we use the hyperboloid model for H2. So this part represents the elliptic rotation in the hyperboloid. And this is the picture of a hyperbolic helicoid. The rotation center is here, the center is here, and these are geodesics. So which one is, yeah, these are geodesics. And these, oh, what is the geodesics? These geodesics rotates and goes up in the same time. It's the parametrization. This is the picture of the hyperbolic helicoid. The rotation center is here, and these are geodesic rulings. And in fact, it rotates, but it looks like to be translated. It's the parametrization. Yeah. So this is it's a homogeneous three manifold whose isometric group is 4. Its metric is two parameter family here. One parameter is here, and the another parameter is tau here. And in fact, all members of this class shares the property that there is a Riemannian vibration. Vibration direction will be in this direction, z direction, in this coordinate. I was told that this metric was computed up by Bianchi. So the fact, this condition is equivalent to this fact. And if tau is zero, then you can understand that if tau is zero, this metric is a product metric. And so this space becomes one of two. And if tau is not zero, then the metric is twisted. And then one can classify the spaces according to the sign of kappa, the base space. Kappa is the the kappa constant is the Gauss curvature of this space. So you can take this as an S2 or R2 or H2. When this base space is R2, this case, then that is called the Niels 3. In fact, its model is a Heisenberg group. And when kappa is positive, then we call it as a Berger sphere. And its model is a SU2. And when kappa is negative, then if we assume that the manifold is simply connected, then you can take universal kappa. So now I will explain our result about this one. Yes, it's another explanation of this space. So it has a special direction. Then the direction along whose axis is E3, the rotation, the only rotation with axis E3 is an isometry. Then any other rotation is not an isometry here. So, and the translation along this direction is again an isometry. So this is a Killing field, and tau is here. And there is a canonical choice of orthonormal frames, and their covariant derivatives are like this one. But if tau is zero, then I mean the Niels 3 case, then just the tau, only tau comes up here. So the computation is a little not complicated. That's one of the reasons why we have a result in the first case in Niels 3. So in Niels 3, the only ruled minimal, non-trivial ruled minimal surface is this one. It's a really helicoid. And another one is this one. So it's a curious one, but it turns out that this hyperbolic paraboloid is a Hausdorff limit of this helicoid. So one can say that essentially in Niels 3, the only ruled minimal surface is a helicoid. One can say that. So in order to prove this one, the key observation is that the fact that the ruling must be orthogonal to the axis. This is a crucial fact. So in order to show this fact, we tried in this way. It's our strategy. So you take a parametrization, and T represents the geodesic direction. And then, as we know the geodesics of Niels 3, we know this xt1, xt2, x3, we know that functions up to initial conditions. And we don't know xs1, xs2, xs3. But we may assume that the parametrization is orthogonal. We know this one. And then, so that function, for that function to be a parametrization of a surface, this must satisfy a Kodachi equation here. And if you written down this equation in terms of E1, E2, E3, then you have this equation. And so here, known functions are, XTs are known functions here. XS are unknown functions. So we were able to solve these equations. And then we get XSs, and then insert this equation. then from this equation we can know that the ruling must be orthogonal. That means that xt3 must be zero, and so we can have the ruled minimal surfaces. But in other cases, I mean, here when kappa is not zero, then means that in these two cases, the connection is very so troublesome. This one in the computation, but so by rescaling, we can have this formula. So the reason is written here. So yeah, homothetic change takes kappa to kappa over a square and tau to into tau a. So we can take proper a homothetic constant, then we may assume that the anyway, it's the result of our rescaling. So in this case, if epsilon is minus one, then it's a Bergère sphere. If epsilon is minus one, then it's a nil three. And if epsilon is less than minus one, then we have this case. And the connection formula is very simple. So we tried to this method. We tried to solve directly xs1, xs2, xs3, but we failed. So we tried another method. The key factor is the introduction of adapted frames. Looking back, in this case, in this case, we didn't respect the surfaces. There is no geometry of ruled surfaces, so we tried. So another frame, also normal frame, respecting the geometry of a ruled surface. So this is a tangent vector of a geodesic. So we know we can solve this one. And if the ruling is not orthogonal, then this is the fiber direction, and this is the ruling direction. Then project it down to the horizontal plane. Then you have a non-zero vector, and rotate this vector by 90 degrees. Then you have another vector v. That's the geometric meaning of the vector field v. And then wedge product is the one. Then the xs is assumed to be orthogonal to xt, then we can set xs as a linear combination of a v and g, v and w. V and w is here. And we tried to express Kodachi equation and the minimal surface equation in terms of f and g. Then the result is this one. So Kodachi equation is this one. But if the ruling is not orthogonal, then A is not non-zero. So this equation becomes here. And it's another equation. But so this equation, and so here, you differentiate once more with respect to t, then gtt, ft is here. And so you have this equation, and so we can solve this equation. And so we from this equation, we have FNG. Then insert this equation to the minimal surface equation. Then we can solve this case. So and the result is that the ruling must be orthogonal. Ruling must be orthogonal or horizontal. That means that here B must be 1 or constant function 1. We assumed that the length of this, the size of this vector is 1. Then the result is A, either B is 1 or either B is 0. That means that the ruling must be always vertical or always horizontal. So, yeah, okay. Stalling, yeah, it's our result. The first case is a vertically ruled minimal surface case. We obtained this parametrization. And then the xt, the ruling direction is the fiber direction. And the x-axis is this direction, but the x-axis is orthogonal to E1 and E3, but it's a horizontal vector. And in fact, it's a vector field of, it's a tangent vector field of a geodesic, in fact. So in this case, we have doubly ruled surfaces. But according to the result of this, how can pronounce it? Soam and Tobiana. In this space, there is no totally geodesic surfaces. So this surface cannot be totally geodesic, just doubly ruled. And the horizontally ruled minimal cases, we have two cases. One case is theta is constant, and another case is theta is not constant. Then when theta is a constant, we have this parameterization. Then when t is 0, this simplifies this one. This shows that So it's a kind of a translation surface because the geodesic direction does not change, just goes up like a translated images. And the final result is this case. In this case, theta is not constant. But when t is 0, then you have this one. So you have a indicatrix curve here. It's a fiber direction. And this shows that the geodesic rotates in the constant speed here and goes up. So this is really the parametrization of a helicoid. So what we have done is that So we have all ruled minimal surfaces in this case. And the remaining question is what is the ruled minimal surface in source 3? So this will be our next topic. So please don't touch this topic. Thank you for your attention.